Chick-fil-A, we didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich. The ESPN Game Day crew in Baton Rouge this morning, and in our Chick-fil-A mascot mover, Coach Corso does the wise thing, at least if you're in Baton Rouge.
Smart man right there. That's self-preservation call right there.
And he keeps Drew Brees happy there. Everybody wins. Three other SEC games on the slate today that we haven't hit yet. In Mississippi State, yeah, they're just 2-3, but Dan Mullen has really re-energized this program.
He has. They're playing with some confidence, obviously, something that they didn't have last year. And Houston right now, everybody wanted to vault them high in the polls. They beat Oklahoma State. They followed that up with a victory at Texas Tech. And the UTEP gets off on them on the running game. And so you got to think, Anthony Dixon, a guy who can run well in the SEC, they're going to feed him a lot in this ball game. Kentucky, South Carolina. Is South Carolina for real? Kentucky dominated that first half outside of right before the half against Alabama last week. They looked pretty good until turnovers really compromised what they were doing. South Carolina, though, looking to round out their offense with their running game and keep Stephen Garcia in that productive rut that he's in. He's in a nice little groove. And then Alabama, Ole Miss. Look, it may not seem like it was the big game that we thought it was going to be going into the season. That being said, it will be tight. The last four times these two teams have met, Bama's won, but by 4 points or less. Jevon Snead is going to have to show up huge in this ball game because you know Bama can score points, and you know that defense is going to stop the run.
And time now for an SEC Network update. Arkansas scoring on their opening drive. They have just converted the extra point, so it is now 7-0 Arkansas over number 17 Auburn. Broderick Green with the touchdown for the Razorbacks. He's number two on the field, but number one in the SEC rushing leader list this season. Senior ball back Montario Hardesty and his 115 yard per game average take to the turf when we return to the SEC Network Game of the Week. Live look from Knoxville as Tennessee runs through the tee.
This is a huge ball game for these Tennessee Volunteers. They're looking to distance themselves from last year's season. If they lose this ball game, they're looking at 5-7 again.
Some rain overnight in Knoxville, some showers in the AM, temperatures in the mid-60s. Interesting about this game, two senior quarterbacks, one for Tennessee, one for Georgia. Where does the losing team go forward at that position?
Well, for Tennessee, it's almost a no-brainer. Since they set foot in Tennessee, Lane Kiffin and his coaching staff have already been pointing towards the future, recruiting. So I think they change it. Joe Cox, he might last because he's their best chance to win.
It'll be something to follow, that's for sure. All right, we'll see you at halftime. Here's Derry, Kara, Andre with the call.
Thank you very much, guys. On an overcast afternoon here in Knoxville, Tennessee, there will be SEC football, Eastern Division football, coming your way. It's our Wrangler SEC Game of the Week, where over 100,000 fans making their way inside this massive structure to watch the Georgia Bulldogs and the Tennessee Volunteers right here on the SEC Network. Well, the Georgia Bulldogs coming off a very tough loss last week, a late loss to LSU. Controversial in some eyes. But when you look at the Eastern Division standings, this is still a football team that very much in control of their own destiny. The way that they keep pace in the East is they win here today. And that is a big must for the Georgia Bulldogs if they want to be relevant in the conversation in the SEC race. Dave Neal alongside my partner, Andre Ware. And Andre, for Georgia to remain relevant, they have got to find a way to run the football. It has been, at times, almost embarrassing what they have done on the ground.
Yeah, three different offensive line combinations this season, and a lot of what they do offensively, Dave, is predicated off the running game. Play action passes to get A.J. Green down the field. And so, mention those three different line changes. They've got to find a way today to run the football. I don't care how you do it, you got to do it today.
Well, they rank 105th in the FBS in rushing the football. On the flip side, Tennessee, of course, under Lane Kiffin in his first year, still trying to find their way a little bit, but one thing that they can rely on, Andre, is the fact that they do run the ball well behind Montario Hardesty.
Yeah, the senior running back has been nothing short of spectacular for Tennessee this season. As Jim Chaney told us yesterday, he's putting together that video resume for the next level. He's been magical, 115 yards a game. He leads the SEC in rushing. He'll have to go and go well today for Tennessee.
A lot of storylines to talk about this afternoon. Lane Kiffin and his Tennessee Volunteer Club 0-2 in the league, so he is seeking his first conference win this afternoon. The 34-year-old coach, youngest in the Football Bowl subdivision. There is Mark Richt, who has been awesome on the road. 31-5 overall in true road games and against SEC competition on the road. This is staggering. 25-4. It's the 39th meeting between these two schools, which goes back to 1899. But how about this? It is the first time since 1937 that neither team is ranked in the AP poll.
It's almost unheard of.
Georgia wins the toss. They defer. Tennessee will receive. And Newkeese Richardson will watch it sail over his head. So Tennessee's offense will come out to the 20-yard line and try to get off to a good start. That has been a problem for the Volunteers this year, getting off to slow starts, getting behind. Jonathan Crompton, speaking of slow starts, just 2 out of 11 to start the game last week. A lot of people looking at him saying he's got to play better.
Yeah, there's no doubt. He had receivers open and basically threw the football behind him. According to the coaching staff, they had 6 drop balls in that game last week. I bet you all 6 were in the first half.
Here we go on first down and 10 from the 20. Play action to Hardesty. Crompton, a lot of time to throw. Passes caught. Quentin Hancock. Out to the 37, making the 38-yard line. Brian Evans brings him down, but an 18-yard pickup right out of the gates.
Boy, that's big for Crompton's confidence to start the game early. Nice play-action pass holding the linebackers. Denarius Moore clears it out on the outside and gives Quentin Hancock a big-time hole in which to catch that football in. Big throw and a big catch.
Another play action to Hardesty. Crompton over the middle, wide open, has his tight end down to the 40-yard line. Luke Stocker with his 7th reception of the year. It's another big orange first down.
Well, you come into this game, if you're Georgia, thinking they're going to run the football, so play action. That's going to hold the linebackers, giving him some nice big holes to throw the football through. We talked about Quentin Hancock, the first reception. Right behind it, the big tight end, Luke Stocker.
Prompt in the last 2 games, 4 touchdowns, 1 interception. 23-yard pickup moments ago. First down and 10. Here's Hardesty with his first carry. Look at him breaking some tackles down to the 32-yard line. The safety Evans finally brings him down.
And you see, Dave, how one aspect of the offense changes the other. Play action, you're respecting the run. Now you come back and you actually run the football after throwing and get 2 plays in a row. That opens up or makes it a little bit easier for the offensive line.
See our starting lineup above our score there for the Tennessee Volunteers. Hardesty still in at tailback. 2nd down, and we'll say 3. It's Hardesty off the right side. Breaks a tackle to the 30. Flag comes in, though. Rennie Curran will get credit for the tackle. It's a first down if the play holds, but I think it's right there where an orange jersey, it might have been holding on to a white jersey.
I think it's going to be the center, Cody Sullins, with a holding penalty.
Here's Steve Shaw, our referee today.
Holding, number 66 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat 2nd down.
Just keep an eye right now on the big fella in the middle. Big Cody Sullins just kind of working outside, and he just gets that hand right around the back of the jersey. That in itself is going to draw the penalty right there by the officials each and every time.
Lane Kiffin talked, Andre, so much about just trying to execute, be efficient on offense. These are the things that he says that just are killing this club right now. It looks like Georgia player jumped into neutral zone. Jeff Owens might have gotten a head start.
Yeah, that's right there. That's senior leadership at the quarterback position. You give up 5-10 yards
before the snap. Ones back. Offsides, number 95 on the defense. Contact. 5-yard penalty. Remain 2nd down.
And that's when the old hard count becomes your best friend. Get yourself back in a manageable situation on 2nd down. Bark those signals out loudly at the line of scrimmage, and maybe you'll get one of those big grunts on the other side to jump off sides.
Well, that was a big concern for Lane Kiffin, was the fact that Georgia's front 4, big, experienced, coming off a great game against LSU. And they had a ton of sacks, 6 sacks last week against the Tigers. Crompton, straight drive, looking up top for the fullback. Kevin Cooper just off his fingertips, incomplete, 3rd down.
What a tough pass. You get the receiver coming down inside. and the fullback leaking out. So you're going to get the receiver coming in here and almost a natural pick and out and up from the fullback. And you'll see him right there. Just got to lead him a little bit more outside away from the defender.
Hardesty in at tailback. Georgia goes into a nickel look. On third down and eight. Over the middle. Pass batted down. Prince Miller, the senior out of Duncan, South Carolina, knocks it down, brings up a fourth down situation.
And you'll see him here, just the eyes, zone coverage by Georgia. So as a quarterback, you can find or open some windows for yourself just by using your eyes, moving defenders around. This was the exact start. They had a big new Keese Richardson kickoff return last week. Got themselves in great field position, but unable to come up with points against Auburn. Same result here with Georgia. A couple of good plays, and now punting the football away.
Jack Cunningham with a pooch punt that will hit at about the seven and be down at the 1 yard line. Good special teams performance. And guess who's down here? Eric Berry.
He is the true definition of a football player. There's no super, you know, he's a superstar, but you don't get that vibe for him. He gets his uniform a little dirty, you know what I'm saying? Just playing on special teams, a lot of guys, you would have to convince them to play special teams. Eric Berry, he wants to play.
The crowd making some noise early as Georgia's backed up to the 1 yard line. Not how you want to start for a Bulldog. Cox, a little keeper, he'll get a yard. Joe Cox, completing about 59% of his passes on the year, over 1,200 yards, 11 touchdowns, 6 interceptions, averaging about 241 a game. What's your impressions of Joe through half the season?
I've liked him, man. A lot of coaches around the SEC respect him and his game. He's throwing the ball right now, Dave, extremely well. Right at 60%, 11 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. I'd like to see that other number, that latter number go down, the interceptions, but I think he's doing a heck of a job. Second in the SEC in touchdown passes.
Richard Samuel gets the start at tailback. It's a movement up front. Well, we had a couple of bodies moving up on that offensive and defensive line.
Well, it looks like it's going to be big Dan Williams. And there again, the senior leadership at quarterback. That hard count, trying to draw Tennessee offsides. They may have got number 55, Dan Williams.
Offsides. Number 55 on the defense. He got in the neutral zone, causing the offense to react. 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
Well, that is a bonus five for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Well, you see how important it is. Backed up, thrown into the field with a senior quarterback. How that could really affect the football game.
Now you're looking at second and four. Here goes A.J. Green in motion. Little toss sweep. Samuel. To the 10-yard line. He'll be about a half a yard shy of a first down. Dan Williams, the defensive tackle, registers the stop for the Big Orange. You look at the Georgia offensive starting lineup above our score with 11 minutes to go here in the opening quarter. Here's Neil Andre with Derek Capiano down on the field. Glad to be with us.
Well, kind of untrue to how we look at Georgia football. The strength of this football, or this offense, has been through the air, throwing it around. Usually you think Georgia, you think of that powerful running game of the Georgia Bulldogs.
Samuel only needed about a yard. I think that'll be good enough from where they're spotting it. If he gets a shade out over the 11, he should have the first down. Eric Berry and Rico McCoy, the two guys that combined for 30 stops last week, combined on that tackle, but they will bring the chains in.
Well, right here, tremendous penetration. You see big Dan Williams in there fighting, trying to get low. Rico McCoy, as you mentioned. Well, we had a nice visit with him yesterday. You talk about a guy with a great personality. Oh, man, when the scouts interview Rico McCoy, just short on the Bulldogs. When the scouts come to interview Rico McCoy, they are in for a treat.
What a stop by Tennessee. Talk about a morale boost. Georgia with that rushing game once again kind of slowing them down. They only needed a yard and got a half a yard.
That's big for the defense when you have that type of momentum swing. You get so hyped up at the start of a game, a couple of big plays in the passing game. for Tennessee and then having to punt the football. Well, it's big for the defense to come up with that stop.
Drew Butler leads the country in punting average at 49.8 yards per punt from his end zone. Nukeish Richardson lets it hit. Did it touch him? Georgia thinks that maybe it did. They will say no. It'll be Tennessee football. So Tennessee will have the football at the 29-yard line when we come back, and we'll get a chance to look at the SEC's top rusher, Montario Hardesty, off to a great senior season. Back in a moment. Scoreless in the first quarter. It's our Wrangler Game of the Week right here on the SEC Network. This was the punt return moments ago from Nukeish Richardson.
Well, it looks like he goes right between his legs. Dangerous, dangerous play on the part of the true freshman. Nukeish Richardson just gets out of the way, and Tennessee going to be set up with some pretty good field position to start this drive, Dave.
Montario Hardesty in at tailback, the SEC's leading rusher, averaging 115 yards a game. Formation. It's Hardesty. Spins his way to the 30. Got about a yard on the play. Boykin brings him down. Let's take a look at the Principal Financial Group edge to the game, beginning with Tennessee's offense.
Yeah, for Tennessee, I think it's throwing and catching the football well. Last week, they dropped a lot of passes early in the football game. We know they're going to be able to run the football. Georgia, defensively, it's to force Tennessee into third down and long, where Jonathan Crompton has been uncomfortable this season.
Looking at a second down and nine. Here's Hardesty working the left side. Georgia's defensive line stood tall. Darryl Gamble among those in on the play for the Bulldogs. That'll bring up a third down and relatively long. Exactly what you were talking about last week with this Tennessee team. Had their worst third down percentage all season. They were just 4 out of 17. That's 23%.
This is it's big. I mean, and for the confidence of Jonathan Crompton, because if you remain in that down and distance throughout the ball game, then you're going to start to see a lot of different looks and a lot of different blitz packages that come with it.
Bryce Brown checks into the game. That's the fullback Cooper in motion. Hit as he throws, pass is caught by Stocker. He's to midfield. He's to the 45 of Georgia, first down, Tennessee.
Boy, so many people talk about the body language of Jonathan Crompton. Well, guess what, Dave? I like it right now. Senior quarterback, nothing happens. He gets flushed out of the pocket, the eyes down the field, squaring the shoulders up, and hitting Luke Stocker right between the two eights, and allowing the big junior tight end to convert the first down and get a little bit of extra yardage.
The flag came out there late at about the 41-yard line, kind of in that defensive area of Georgia. I wonder what that was. Steve Schaubel.
I don't know if this is a substitution penalty.
Illegal block in the back, number 4 on the offense. That's a 10-yard penalty from the end of the run. The play will result in a first down, Tennessee.
Said lost yardage at the end of the day when you start tallying things up as a coach and you see, you know, just where you miss certain things or certain opportunities, because you're across midfield, that might change the play calling a little bit. Maybe you want to take a shot right now, get yourself a big play after converting the first down on third and long.
That's the third penalty today against Tennessee already. Inside handoff on first down to Bryce Brown. Not much happening. Take a look at our impact players brought to you by Hampton Inn at Hampton. We love having you here.
Yes, indeed. I think it starts with the quarterback, Jonathan Crompton. 4 touchdowns, only 1 interception in the last 2 games. Gerald Jones, we think he's going to have to make a big impact today on the outside to soften up this Georgia defense. And then Eric Berry. And what more can you say about him? 3rd in the SEC in tackles, just a phenomenal football player.
Remember, Crompton started last week 2 out of 11. He's off to a good start today, 3 out of 5. On second down, we'll throw it again. It's the fullback Cooper. Breaks a tackle and lost the football out of bounds, but I think it'll be close to that first down marker. That may be a first down. Darius Dewberry hit him out of bounds or hit him on the sideline. And they will spot it down at the 43-yard line.
What's the play action here, right here? That motion just going to hold the linebackers and give the fullback an opportunity to get out. What I like is the decision, though, on the play. No delay from Jonathan Crompton, the quarterback. He's throwing it, and sometimes as a quarterback, you start to get that feel a little bit, and the confidence rises. You feel like you can make every throw. Right now, I like the rhythm that Jonathan Crompton's in early.
Well, he had a great fourth quarter last week when Lane Kiffin decided to go for obvious reasons. They were trailing, went to that no-huddle, hurry-up offense, and it got Crompton kind of going a little bit.
Yeah.
Maybe there's a carryover.
Well, the receivers catch the ball for you. It carries over from week to week.
Third down, toss sweep, Hardesty. Georgia strung it out perfectly. Justin Houston, the defensive end, kind of forced him out of bounds. The sophomore out of Statesboro, Georgia, had six tackles, a couple of sacks against the Tigers last week in Athens.
Well, if you get anything positive there, then it almost becomes decision time for Lane Kiffin. But doesn't this have the feel of a big-time prize fight where two opponents trying to feel one another out? And, you know, whoever makes the first mistake might get the punch landed on them. That's exactly kind of what it feels like to me right now between Tennessee and Georgia.
Cunningham will punt it away. Georgia fields it. Prince Miller at the goal line. Gets it out over the 10 to the 12-yard line, and that's where Georgia will have it. 6:27 to go in the first quarter. Joe Cox getting set to take the field for the second time. On the banks of the Tennessee River, it's SEC football right here on the SEC Network. Georgia and Tennessee, one of the great traditions and sights in all of college football. We are scoreless, 6:27 to go here in the opening quarter.
I like that hat my man was rocking on the boat.
Yeah, we need
SEC
some of those up
Network
here,
Pub. How about that?
The Washon Ely in the football game for Georgia at tailback. The Bulldogs decided to take the red shirt off the youngster last week against LSU. Back to throw. Pass is high, but caught on the far side. Michael Moore able to bring it in for the Bulldogs. Let's check in with Kara down on the sidelines. Kara.
Well, guys, today's two head coaches would really like to see some takeaways. Georgia head coach Mark Richt, his squad, 115th in the nation in turnover margin. Meantime, Lane Kiffin's squad, a little bit better turnover margin, but only two takeaways the last two games, none against Auburn last week. Kiffin knows that this Neyland crowd really responds to those big game-changing plays. He'd like to harness the passion of the fans.
Thank you, Kara. Here's A.J. Green, his first grab. Out to the 28-yard line. Dennis Rogan brings him down.
Yeah, Dave, you know, when you look at it, when I start getting ready for a game early in the week, first stat I look at, turnover margin, because that tells me a lot about what a football team does. I think it has a direct reflection on wins and losses. I was shocked when I looked at Georgia's turnover margin. -9 in the first five games. Unbelievable.
First down and 10 for the Bulldogs. Ely still in the game. 8 carries, 33 yards last week against LSU in his debut. Play action to Ely. Here's Cox. Is that a grab? I believe Michael Moore may have held on to that. What a grab on the sideline by the senior out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. That's big time.
How about knowing exactly where you are on the field? Right there. That's great presence in mind. And this ball is placed where only his receiver is going to catch it. All you need is 1 foot in college football. That is a nice grab by Michael Moore.
Michael Moore needed to step up today. Tavares King not with the team. Michael Moore now with 15 grabs on the year. Second down and short. Ely with the carry. He will take it close to the 40, and that will be a first down for the Bulldogs. Let's take a look at our impact players brought to you by Hampton Inn. At Hampton, we love having you here. Here are the Dogs.
For Georgia, it's Joe Cox. It starts there, second in the SEC, or tied for second in the SEC with 11 touchdown passes. He has been steady. A.J. Green, a superstar on the outside, leads the SEC in receiving yards. And Rennie Curran is just a tackling machine on the other side of the football for Georgia.
Marlon Brown, a true freshman receiver, to the near side. First down and 10, Dogs. Cox, a lot of time to throw. It's Moore again out over the 45 to the close to the 47-yard line. LaMarcus Thompson went on the tackle, the junior linebacker out of Lithonia, Georgia.
Where sometimes we talk about chemistry between quarterbacks and receivers. This is just basically a three-step drop, reading things out. But Michael Moore, what I like is he keeps working in zone coverage to find just a little window for Joe Cox to throw the football to him. It's a little completion, but it goes a long way, especially when it's on first down and sets up second and short.
Georgia has second down and a long three. Cox again, this time it's Green. That's another first down. The 6'4", 205-pound sophomore, run out of bounds by Dennis Rogan. Second grab of the afternoon by Green.
Well, the coaches describe him as a humble young man and just kind of lets his play speak for itself. He committed to Georgia early and just stayed with his commitment. Coaches were coming in trying to convince him to switch and come to their school. No, didn't even want to talk to him.
A lot of people thought he might go to South Carolina, or Clemson, being from South Carolina, but he hung in there with Mark Richt and the Bulldogs, never wavered. Nice throw by Cox to lead Green. Stutter steps, picks up 8 on the play. Eric Berry forces him out of bounds.
You know, we were talking at the top about A.J. Green, and I said, you know, it's a wonder that you don't have, he's not in Heisman talk with these types of numbers. Watch right here the athletic ability setting up the block of Michael Moore. He keeps playing this way, and we're going to mention his name, and don't call it crazy when you start mentioning a receiver for the Heisman Trophy. He is electric.
You and I have talked about it. There are few, if any, better than A.J. Green in the country at his position. They'll swing it near side looking for the freshman, Rantavius Wooten. They'll say incomplete pass. Tennessee thought for a moment that might have been behind a backwards pass, but it wasn't.
No, that's what Joe Cox, Dave's going to wish he had back. Put a little bit too much mustard on that one, as the old coach used to tell me. Take a little mustard off that, baby. All you want to do in that situation is throw a nice catchable ball out in front of the receiver and allow him to make a play for you.
The third down now and 2.5. Timeout taken by Georgia on a third down with 2:46 to go in the opening quarter. Joe Cox off to a good start, completed 6 passes already. Of course, a busy day in the Southeastern Conference and some headlines around the league. How about the SEC West dominating the East at this point? It's the first time in a long time that we've actually talked about the West more than the East race. Tigers back in the polls. They're in the top 25. A tough one today over at Arkansas. And SEC supremacy on the line. And that is LSU, Florida. Will Tim Tebow play? So many thoughts about that. Andre, I don't think he plays today, but you say that my man's going
to
suit up.
They will have to chain him to Gainesville somewhere in order for Tim Tebow not to play in that football game. Two undefeated teams going at it. He's been waiting on this one all season long. You think he's not trying to get back? If he's on that trip, look for 15 to be on the field today.
Smokey looking to the sky. Maybe there's some help coming up on this third down for the Tennessee defense. That'd be a good one. I can't wait.
No, that's going to be a good football game.
All right. Crowd making some noise. Third down and a long two. Cox out of the shotgun. Ely still in the game. Intercepted by Tennessee. Chris Walker comes up with the interception, the junior out of Memphis, Tennessee. It was a tipped ball in the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, Chris Walker comes up with the interception, but it was Dan Williams who has been extremely active up front. Right in here, the big fella. Extremely active up front for Tennessee. You see him right there. Nice swim move getting to Joe Cox. And actually, it's a peel back by Gerald Williams, the defensive end. But it was caused by Dan Williams, a quick throw by the pressure of Dan Williams.
Brompton, nice play fake, rolls out, pass caught, first down. Quentin Hancock with the reception, but you know, that's the second interception by Chris Walker. He had an interception return for a touchdown against Ohio. So Walker in a defensive end, the coaches say he's just a real playmaker.
Yeah, a lot of activity going on in that front four of Tennessee, but Chris Walker came in. Also, Dave, leading the Volunteers in sacks with four this season.
See if this Tennessee offense can get something going after the turnover. Hardesty, the tailback. Some movement against Tennessee. And Lane Kiffin might blow a gasket here in a moment.
Well, you know, it drives a coach crazy. You get some positive plays going, and then all of a sudden those silly penalties start to pop up.
Tennessee pointing across the line of scrimmage.
Before the snap, false start, number 88 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
A Georgia player jumped, but he got himself back, and then Luke Stocker commits the false start penalty for Tennessee. And boy, just first and 15, tough to convert.
Tennessee came into this game third in the country in fewest penalties. They averaged 28 yards a game in penalties. Georgia came in ranked 115th, averaging almost 75 yards a game in penalties, and already today, four violations against the Vols.
Mix that with the turnovers, and you got a 3-2 record, and lucky to be there.
Hardesty, look at him run. Threw a couple of white jerseys, dragging Rashad Jones along for the ride.
You know, he senses that this is his last go around, his senior season, so why not go out on top and at least pouring everything you have into it? And he's been nothing short of focused this season in running the football. 115 on the ground, a game for Tennessee. Montario Hardesty.
He's eighth in the country in rushing, not only leading the league, but in the top 10 nationally. Second down and 5. Breaks another tackle, gets it down to the 30-yard line, first down, Tennessee.
You know, he and Rico McCoy are pretty good buddies. And Rico introduced his father to Hardesty, who is a, you know, more laid-back personality off the field. And when he introduced him to his father, he said, "That's two?" You know, he couldn't believe it because he runs way different than his personality is away from the football field. He's looking for the contact and delivering for Tennessee.
Ball's a line up in the eye on first down and 10. Here goes Bryce Brown. He breaks a tackle. Two tackles. Down to the 23-yard line. Bakari Rambo brings him down finally. But Tennessee seems to be running with some passion today.
You know, and I to be quite honest, talking yesterday, I didn't feel like Lane Kiffin thought he could run the football between the tackles. Two 300-pounders in there, and Cade West and Jeff Owens, and they're undersized with the Sullins brothers, 6'1", 270, and the other at center, Cody Sullins, 6'1", 260. Didn't feel like they could get the push they wanted, but Tennessee having some success running the football between the tackles.
You see that 1 yard rushing a year ago, you can throw that out the window as Tennessee seems to be running and throwing effectively here, but the bottom line is they haven't put any points on the board. We have played 15 minutes at Neyland Stadium. It's the Dogs and the Vols, and we are scoreless.
Core Houston at 2-3, Mississippi State. First quarter, Case Keenum on the run. And how about sophomore Charles Mitchell picking it up, scooping it for the pick six, 7-0 Bulldogs in the first.
thank you very much for the update, Rob. Of course, a busy day in the league, but the Bulldogs making some strides. I think the folks in Starkville getting a little excited about Dan Mullins.
Yeah, I felt like my alma mater, the University of Houston, was going to have a little tough time going into Starkville today.
Here it's second down and short. Couple of tight ends. Hardesty in at tailback. We'll get the handoff. Balls forward inside the 20, down to the 19. That will be a first down. Andre, how about the Vols? I mean, they have racked up over 120 yards of offense already in just a few seconds outside of one quarter.
Well, you know, he wasn't going to just line up to run the football just to run it. He looked at it early. Georgia's kind of packed in. And now I'm going to throw the football a little bit. I had a senior quarterback. I got a little confidence in him. And let's get some confidence early in the game. Then the running game comes with it.
First down and 10. Brown off the right side. Bryce down to the 16. Darius Dewberry, the senior linebacker out of Fort Valley, Georgia, with his second stop this afternoon. But I want to go back to Crompton for a minute because Lane Kiffin had talked at length with us yesterday about confidence, and he's had to spend a lot of time trying to build the confidence with Jonathan Crompton. It seems like that work has at least paid off today.
Well, a lot of different ways you can do that with a quarterback, and especially early in a football game, a couple of easy throws just to get his feet under him a little bit.
Checked off at the line of scrimmage. Bryce Brown with a tailback. It's a movement up front. Looked like Tennessee's left side of the line started caving in.
You always hear me talk about, we'll get the official ruling here.
Before the snap, false start, number 79 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, remain second down.
Coaches will tolerate effort penalties, holding, things of that, you know, during a game when the ball has been snapped. It's the stuff that occurs before the ball is snapped that drives a coach absolutely crazy.
And that man right there doesn't make many mistakes. 31 straight starts, their senior leader, their best offensive lineman out of Riverdale, Georgia. But at 345 pounds, if he moves, you notice. Dropped it all day to throw over the middle, incomplete, looking for Luke Stocker. And a flag comes in late, down at the 3-yard line.
Maybe a little bit too much bumping as the receiver was kind of exposed there. Maybe didn't even have to touch him once the ball's gone over the receiver's head. But that's the one time in this game I've watched Jonathan Crompton kind of lock on to a receiver. He did there.
Pass interference, number 9 on the defense. That'll be a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
It's on Rashad Jones.
Made contact with the ball in the air.
One of the better safeties, not only in the SEC, but around the country. He is a big-time player for Georgia. This is where, you know, the crowd's kind of getting into this, and this is where you want them quiet a little bit. As a quarterback, got to quiet them down, Jonathan.
So first and goal from the 6. Stocker in motion. Rocking. All day to throw again, this time through the hands of Gerald Jones. He threw a bullet to the junior, and he couldn't hang on. Take a look at our Papa John's first quarter statistics, and really heavily leaning toward the big orange.
Yeah, you see it there, the rushing yards dominated by Tennessee in the first quarter, passing yards as well. But the penalties, if you can eliminate the penalties and keep yourself out of first and 15 or backing yourself up to 3rd and 7, that will go a long way offensively for this Volunteer football team.
Play action. Gerald Jones. Touchdown, Tennessee.
Somebody step up in the receiving core, and you called it, my man, Gerald Jones. Watch the play action. You got to respect the run right here. You get all the flow, and now you're outflanked by a receiver sneaking out the backside.
Going after by Daniel Lincoln. It's up, and it is good. So Tennessee This offense clicking on all cylinders here in the first half today against the Georgia Bulldogs. And Jonathan Crompton looking all world.
No doubt the play action. He's been on the money, throwing it right out in front of Gerald Jones. Tennessee leads 7-0.
Welcome back to the Wrangler SEC Game of the Week. Be sure to stay tuned to see which player is selected as the Wrangler five-star player of the game. Right now, a couple of guys trying to make a case for that. You look at the Tennessee scoring drive, Gerald Jones with a six-yard TD reception. But how about Jonathan Crompton, 6 out of 9, 93 yards to start this game.
Great start. Now, I got to give you credit. You called it yesterday. You said Gerald Jones has got to have a big game for Tennessee. Who catches the first touchdown pass? Your guy.
Gerald Jones. Return the kick about 2 yards deep. Boykin has a seam. He already has a 100-yard kickoff return for a touchdown this year. You can make it 2. Touchdown, Georgia.
You hit me with a haymaker, I'm going to hit you right back with one of my own. How about this? This crease is going to open up big time right there. And a great block. And then it's all Brandon Boykin, the speed on along the sideline. Special teams player of the week once already this season for Georgia. And I think you might be able to wrap up another one for that young man.
The sophomore out of Fayetteville, Georgia, came in averaging 26.5 yards per kickoff return. He had a 100-yarder against South Carolina, and you could add another one here against Tennessee. Tied at 7. Well, how do you respond after giving up a touchdown? Well, the answer with a 100-yard kickoff return. That's what Georgia did.
No problem.
Yeah, piece of cake. Just give me the football, says Brandon Boykin. His second 100-yard kickoff return this season. Of course, now 501 kick return yards. Tops in the Southeastern Conference. Now, Newkeese Richardson, a dangerous return man. He will stand back alongside David Oku. Two true freshmen. Don't see that very often in your return game. Blair Walsh picks it off. It'll be Richardson. Newkeese, he's got some room. For the 40, and flags come in everywhere. A face mask against the Dogs. We'll add 15.
Yeah, I think this was going to be tack on 15. Like the face mask of Newkeese Richardson gets grabbed a little bit.
During the return, personal foul, face mask on the kicking team. That'll be 15-yard penalty added to the end of the return, first and 10.
Let's go back and take a look at the kickoff by Brandon Boykin right here. And he's going to pick up an excellent block by number 55, Mike Gilliard, right there. Nice block. Now he just seals it, and it's just off to the races. But a guy, a sure tackler, leads him in special teams. Eric Berry right there takes a bad angle, and it costs Tennessee a touchdown. You don't see that much from the junior safety of Tennessee.
Here's Hardesty off the right side. This time Georgia bottles him up. No gain on the play.
Well, no panic on the part of Tennessee. Not trying to get too much too fast. Go right back to what we did to gain the lead at one point in this game, and that's running the football, an effective passing game. Want to eat up a little bit of clock as well.
Jones in motion. In the backfield, it's the fullback, Austin Johnson. First down, Tennessee to the 33.5 yard line. His second reception of the season for the sophomore out of Hickory, North Carolina.
The play action. action right here is causing, right here, the play fake. It's allowing the linebackers to just have to hold inside and holding them just long enough to get the fullback out in the flat right there. Just enough of it. They can't just go running out there to cover up the fullback, and it's a nice big throwing lane for Jonathan Crompton.
Pass is caught. Denarius Moore breaks a tackle. He's on his way. They will mark him out of bounds, close to the front. Oh, they decide it's a touchdown. After discussion, give him six. Four, number six.
Well, let's take a look at this. Denarius Moore maybe stretching the football just over the pylon. Tennessee trying to line up and kick this extra point before the officials upstairs can take a look at this one. What an athletic play.
Steve Shaw.
Yeah, they definitely have to take a look at this one. But we described this as a prize fight early. Everybody just, you know, two fighters in the middle of the ring just feeling each other out, and then they decided to let's get it on. And right here, Denarius Moore stretching. Look at this athletic play. Oh yeah. Oh, that's close. And you gotta have indisputable video evidence to overturn this one. He's not out of bounds when he takes off. The ball looks like it's over the pylon,
and
I'm going to say
foot,
touchdown.
And watch his left foot. I believe it's his left foot. It was look, almost about to touch, and then he, like, jerked it up just at the last second so it never hit the ground. It's the ruling is a touchdown, so it better be something that they visually, indisputably can see.
Yep. You know what I like about it? The hang time.
Yeah.
Well, it's like my hang time when I go to the hoop.
Oh,
how about
on.
That?
Come on. Come on.
This is me right here going to the hoop, baby. Get out of my way.
And then you clank it off the bottom of the
That's
iron.
That's it. Yeah, the bottom of the net.
I'll tell you what, that's going to be a hard.
I think it's going to stand. Yeah. He takes off right there, right inside the 5-yard line, and the presence of mind to just kind of stick the football over.
And it's the pylon going straight up is what you have to envision. Did he, if you took a string and dropped it straight down on top of that pylon, was he able to hit that string? And I think, you know, I have to say that I think he probably would have yanked that string.
Well, what I like is the tackle. When he breaks the tackle, gets outside away from the defenders, and then speed. Look at the hang time. What a great athletic play by Denarius Moore.
That's a touchdown.
Yeah,
I got to go touchdown.
Yep.
I got to go touchdown. Left foot never hits, and then would he have pulled the string had it been straight up and down from the pylon? I say yes.
Boy, what an excellent play, though.
How about Crompton? He's already hit six different receivers today.
After review, the call on the field stands. It is a touchdown.
Boy, this is a receiving core. And we talked with Lane Kiffin and the coaches, Jim Chaney, the offensive coordinator, yesterday. They put six of them on the ground. Watching some film last night of Tennessee, I'll bet all six were in the first half. But this is a receiving core that has really bounced back and caught the ball well today.
Daniel Lincoln's point after is up and good. Denarius Moore with a touchdown reception. Gerald Jones with a touchdown reception. And Tennessee leads Georgia 14-7. Boy, you want to talk about some athletic ability? Watch Denarius Moore.
Time now for an SEC Network update. Arkansas putting a world of hurt on number 17 Auburn. The Tigers fumbled a kickoff two plays later. Ryan Mallett to Greg Childs. It is now 20-3 in favor of the Razorbacks.
Wow, Rob, that's kind of shocking. I thought Arkansas would give them a game, but it's not much of a game right now.
Hey, he's saying this is our house. They're gonna come to our house and run things. Razorbacks look sharp today.
All right, so the Moore touchdown makes it a 14-7 game. Tennessee out in front. Boy, this This game got a lot of points in a few moments.
First quarter, nothing happened. Right. Then all of a sudden, it turned to the next 15 minutes and all sorts of stuff broke out.
Chad Cunningham will kick it off. Brandon Boykin. Back to return for the Dogs. This time they will keep it away from Mr. Boykin. Actually, he'll pick it up on a hop. Spins out of one tackle. They will mark the ball. Oh, fair catch called for. Didn't see the arm go up. And because of that, as soon as the ball was touched, that's where it will lie. So it's hard to believe college basketball season is right around the corner. Georgia fans, get your tickets now to the third annual SEC Big East Invitational held at Madison Square Garden on December 9th and watch the Bulldogs take on DePaul, followed by a battle between UConn and Kentucky. For more details, visit SECBigEastInvitational.com.
It's going to be fun. Fun basketball tournament.
Look at the time of possession.
Yeah, dominated by Tennessee.
Rashawn Ely in a tailback. Delay handoff. Ely got it back to the line of scrimmage. Georgia today rushing the football. 5 carries, 7 yards.
It's been tough going up front. Guys like Wes Brown and Dan Williams playing solid football. Chris Walker, the junior defensive end.
Well, Dan Williams hobbling off. Wes Brown hobbling off. He's been bothered by knee injuries his whole career. Here's Cox under pressure. Throws. That pass is caught by Moore, his fourth catch today. Let's check in with our studio. Rob, what do you got?
Kentucky at number 25, South Carolina, our third lead change already. Derek Locke, the SEC's all-purpose yard leader so far this season, runs in from 11 out. Wildcats regain the lead 10-7.
And in Kentucky, Derek Locke didn't believe it, but 4-2-1 in the 40 on pro day. That means it's legitimate.
Look at those standings right there. Of course, Georgia's still in the mix in terms of a discussion for an SEC East crown, but they got to get it going. Pass is dropped out of the 30-yard line by the true freshman Marlon Brown, and there will be a flag that comes in.
Yeah, personal foul penalty, and this may be one of those helmet-to-helmet contact deals, or maybe a forearm to the head. But Marlon Brown, true freshman, as you mentioned, they want to really get him going. He was Mr. Football in 2008 in the state of Tennessee.
Well, there is a full-on discussion back inside the 20. Steve Shaw and his crew trying to figure this out. You know, it's one of those things, you just got to stay away from the headgear.
Well, Jansen Jackson, another freshman, comes in with that blow. Art Evans, Jansen Jackson, secondary guys in there. Officials, I never understand this. You throw the flag, either he did it or he didn't do it. But if you throw the flag, he did it.
Yeah.
We'll take another look at it. Matched against Art Evans. He gets inside. Big frame at 6'5".
Before the snap, it was a dead ball, false start, number 8 on the offense. Therefore, we have no play. Downfield, there is no flag. There was a dead ball.
So there was a violation in terms of a blow to the head.
Yes.
But you got to wave it off because it was a dead ball foul back in the line of scrimmage. So basically a free shot for Jansen Jackson.
So none of that other stuff took place. It's like it was there and then it was just erased from our memory.
Now Georgia looking at the third and long, backed up, and the crowd making a lot of noise here at Neyland Stadium. Here's the screen. Chappis. He may have got the first down. He did at the 25-yard line.
You know, and you don't usually screen to a big fullback like Sean Chappis. He's caught 7 passes coming into this game, but right here fooling everybody. Just allow the defense to get to you. And right here, you're going to get some nice penetration up the field by the defensive line. And then Joe Cox, let him get to his lap right now. Then dump it up to the fullback. And what I like more than anything, he didn't hesitate, try to make anybody miss, get to the first down marker.
Yeah, fullbacks aren't usually dancing around. That's what I like about the fullback.
Yeah, they like contact and straight ahead.
Here's a toss sweep to Ealy. Ealy will pick up 3.5, and here comes a flag from deep in the secondary. Dan Williams pulls him down, the senior out of Memphis, Tennessee.
Well, you've called his name a lot today. And he didn't start the season as a starter.
Just felt he needed a little kick in the backside to maybe get him going a little bit, and it's worked.
Illegal block in the back, number 82 on the offense. 2-yard penalty from the end of the run, repeat first down.
And Michael Moore, the guilty player for Georgia, so that's going to cost him 10 yards. But I had a chance last year. I was watching some film on Washaun Ealy. He is going to be fantastic. His senior year, he rushes for over 2,200 yards, 41 touchdowns, and caught 13 passes to go along with it for another 5 TD receptions. He's going to be unbelievable by the time he leaves Georgia.
There is Ealy. This time he stuffed maybe a yard of the play. Just to finish up that thought on Ealy, of course, he was a high school All-American, but he set a Georgia high school single season touchdown record with 58 and 07, and he finished his high school career with 133 touchdowns, which was 20 more than the previous record, which was held by Darius Walker of Notre Dame fame.
Over 8,100 yards it's rushing.
It's disgusting. The
in high school. Yeah, you just, no big deal. Just 2,000 yards a year. That's it.
And they could use it if you look at that number
amazing.
Right there. 98 yards a game for the Dogs on the ground. But they will go to the air, and it's caught by Marlon Brown to the 29-yard line. Bring up third down.
Good job there by the true freshman coming back to the football. If you wait on it, it gives defenders in zone coverage an opportunity to break on the football. Hard to teach to a young receiver to come back to the football. Those windows stay open a long time in high school.
Looking like he was coming full speed on a blitz. He backs off now. Barry still up at the line of scrimmage. He's coming. Cox fires out pattern. A.J. Green dancing around. Steps out of bounds back at the 47-yard line. But a first down for the Dogs.
Boy, you take a chance when you blitz and you put a corner on an island with A.J. Green, a big-time playmaker on the outside. And Joe Cox going to buy just enough time. You see the guys there blitzing. Here comes Eric Berry. Here comes Rico McCoy. And they don't get there. Now you've got a guy outside and Marcellus Johnson one-on-one with A.J. Green, a nightmare for a corner.
First down and 10. Cox will throw again. Throws a bullet over the middle and a rare drop by A.J. Green. He can't believe it.
Boy, Joe Cox, unbelievable throwing the football. Came in, we mentioned it, just under 60%, 11 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. He throws this one on a rope. And I mean, a couple of defenders got a nice break on it. Savion Frazier, the middle linebacker, breaks on the football, but is thrown with so much velocity that he's unable to get a hand on it, and you don't see the big fella drop many.
Well, that's a rarity. Second down and 10. Here's a handoff. Thomas makes a man miss. He gets it down to the 41-yard line. That's good enough for a first down. Frazier brings him down. The junior out of Woodbridge, Virginia, stepping in at linebacker for the injured Nick Reves, who's out for the season.
Carlton Thomas had an excellent spring for Mark Rick in this Georgia football team. He's a smaller back at 5'7", about 180 pounds, smaller, quicker. Just a good change of pace type back for Georgia.
Israel Troop checks in at wide receiver. He's to the top of the screen, more to the near side. Georgia works out of the I formation. Here's Ealy. Ealy down to the 35-yard line. Well, all season long, Champion Apparel will be showcasing the tradition and history of the SEC. And today we take a look at this historic Neyland Stadium, which was built back in 1921. It was a when you think about it, it was just a little facility. Just a little over 3,000 people could get in. And now it's up over 100,000. Of course, only Bobby Dodd Stadium with Georgia Tech. They have posted more wins at their stadium than Tennessee. For Cox. Incomplete, looking for more.
Like it. Second down and medium, second and four. Nobody's there. Don't try to force one. You can convert on third down. Good leadership at that position. Throw the football away. Come back on third down. I like Joe Cox. You know, he's a guy that knows patience. Sat behind Chris Leak in high school, a guy that went on to win a national championship. He gets to Georgia. Matthew Stafford is here at Georgia. Waited his turn, and I think he's played some excellent football for the Bulldogs.
12th play of this drive coming up for the Dogs. It is third down and four. Another all-out blitz. Cox just has to throw it up. Cox pushed all the way back to his own 40-yard line.
Yeah, the Volunteers blitz, and he's trying to set a screen to Wishon Ely. And it gets read perfectly by Tennessee's defense. Nowhere to go with the football. You see the blitz coming? He's waiting. But they're right there in the hip pocket of Wishon Ely. Nowhere to go with the football. So throw it away and give our kicker a chance to knock one through.
Boy, this will be a long field goal attempt. They will spot it at the 53-yard line.
Thinking like Joe Cox up here.
This is career long, is 53. Blair Walsh, 8 out of 9 this year. Snap's good. Kick is on the way. It is good from 53 yards out.
What you want to do, you don't want to throw an interception or take a sack in that situation. If you're a quarterback, you're thinking, you know, hey, we got a good football, we got a good kicker, let's give him a chance to knock one through. Georgia draws a little bit closer, 14-10 Tennessee.
On the campus at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville, it's our SEC Game of the Week, presented by Wrangler. Dave Neal along with Andre Ware down on the sidelines. Karen Capuano, glad you could be with us in what has been an entertaining first half of football. 14-10, Tennessee trying to win their first SEC game for new head coach Lane Kiffin. You saw some of the numbers there. It was a Boykin kickoff return for 100 yards. It brought a little life to the Bulldogs, and then the 52-yard field goal. We say 52. It was just a shade inside the 53, yeah. So officially it will go as a 52. One off the career long for Blair Walsh. Nonetheless, it counts for three. I say give him 53-yarder. Mookeese Richardson at the 10. And he is dropped at the 26-yard line. With that, time for us to head back to the SEC Network studios. Rob.
Guys, the Arkansas onslaught continues. Ryan Mallett to DJ Williams. Mallett, his second touchdown of the day, 14-21 for 149 yards. The lead swells to 24.
Andre, I don't even know what to say about that. I'm
impressed with the big guy.
Ryan Mallett.
Oh, my goodness. Can he throw it around the park? And understanding Bobby Petrino's offense in the very first year, unreal.
Auburn has won 4 out of 6 in that series, but it looks like that might stop. Here's Stocker with the first down catch out over the 40 to the 41.
You know, you made a good point earlier when you were talking about Lane Kiffin and your conversation with him and how to settle Jonathan Crompton down. I think when you start a football game and keep him in the pocket, you almost handcuff him a little bit. He's an athletic guy who throws well on the move in a lot of different ways. Sometimes it's three-step drops that get quarterbacks into a rhythm early. Sometimes it's bootleg passes that we've seen him throw on a couple of occasions here in this game.
Stocker comes in motion, but he's been sharp, no question about it. Here's Hardesty. He's been sharp all season, leading the league in rushing. But back to the Crofton thing for a moment. And that, you know, we tend to forget coming out of high school, Andre, he was the second-rated quarterback, yeah, only behind Mark Sanchez. I mean, it's not like he can't play.
And, you know, Mark Richt said himself, we recruited him. You know, there wasn't a lot of people around the country who didn't want Jonathan Crofton on their football team. And I think he's just been through a lot, five different offenses, four offensive coordinators, a lot of football swimming around in that head. You know, somebody's going to get him a good quarter. I think he's going to be in camp for somebody next season.
Back to the line of scrimmage. You know, maybe Lane Kiffin's onto something here, rolling him out, doing what you're talking about. You look at the first five games, struggled early, yet last week came on strong in the fourth, and that no huddle speed him up offense, mm-hmm, there. And today, I mean, his numbers are off the charts. 9 out of 12, a buck 53. Come on.
Well, the timing has been off in the passing game. Whether receivers are lining themselves wrong or cutting routes off short, dropping passes, it's all reflected. It all goes back in the quarterback's lap.
The fake toss sweep being chased down. Crofton throws back. John Jones with the catch. He's to the 30. Down to the 20-yard line. Rashad Jones finally brings him out. But that time, Jones helped out his quarterback.
How about the throw by J.C.? Number 8, big-time play from Tennessee quarterback Jonathan Crofton. Look at this one, right on the money. Right in the middle of that four, and the little guy, Gerald Jones, making a nice adjustment to the football. I'm not quite finished yet. And then turning it into a big game. Look at the reaction of him. Nothing, you know, just even keel right there. I know what I'm doing today.
Gerald Jones having a good afternoon as well, already with one touchdown grab. It's first down and 10, Tennessee. Another play action everywhere. Crofton over the middle. Denarius Moore. It'll be first and goal, Tennessee. It's clicking for the big orange.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are seeing execution at the highest level at the quarterback position right now. This is a guy that is absolutely feeling it right here. Play action, got a short rolling. They have got it covered up. We call it a smash route. You've got a sit-down route on the outside and a corner route with a little bit of drag coming from the backside by Denarius Moore. He makes the adjustment with his shoulders, throwing it back in the middle of the field. Excellent play.
200 yards. Another rollout. Back over the middle, wide open. Touchdown, Marsalis Teague and Tennessee. Where have you been all year, Jonathan Crofton?
I think it takes the team of Neil and Ware to come to town, because every time we come in here, he has a big-time game. Watch the play action once again. Going to hold the linebackers and then sneaking one across the back line of the end zone right there. Settling in nicely, Marsalis Teague.
Lincoln's point after. Up and good. If I wasn't sitting here watching with my own eyes, it'd be hard to believe that Jonathan Crofton is putting on a quarterback clinic. Three touchdown strikes in the opening half. Marsalis Teague with his second touchdown reception of the year. You know, he opened the season with 6 grabs against Western Kentucky, but only had 1 catch since that game.
And another
coaches wanted him to step it up.
Another freshman contributing.
Boykin will take it at the 20. Makes a couple of guys. Smith dropped at the 32-yard line. 2:35 to go here in the opening half. Let's go to our studios. Rob.
Dave, fun one in Columbia. Kentucky 0-2 in SEC play. Given South Carolina everything they got, Mike Hartline to Randall Cobb. It's the 5th lead change of the game already. Wildcats up 3.
What was he on that drive?
Well, Kentucky trying to find their first SEC win. Randall Cobb, one of the premier players in this conference.
He is a good, solid football player.
Come right here. Tennessee. Here's Cox. Pressure comes in as he throws. Boy, did he get leveled by Eric Berry.
I'm going to tell you what, I'm not going to hold it too long if I see 1-4 coming in. They're trying to set a screen from Richard Samuel, and it's just taking a little bit too long. Right there, waiting. Got to get rid of it. That is a guy that can hit you and make it hurt for a long time.
Richard Samuel to the 37. He'll be about 4 yards shy of the first down. It'll be third down coming up for the Bulldogs, who desperately need to keep their offense on the field right now.
Yeah, Samuel's a good young player himself. He enrolled at Georgia when he was 16 years old in January, and then he turned 17 in just enough time to compete in spring football. So he's a youngster, but he plays big. 6'2", 222 pounds.
Jay Green to the top of your screen. Pressure comes, and Joe Cox is lit up again, looking for his tight end.
Big
Carson Charles, and it's big Dan Williams, 325 pounds, laying on top of Joe Cox.
He might not have a lot of tackles, but the big fella inside, watch the activity up front. Right there, nice swim move. If there's one thing he can do, he can swim offensive linemen, because we've seen it on about three occasions today, and he puts that big face mask right between the one and the four on Joe Cox's jersey. That's got to hurt, Dave.
That was painful. Drew Butler to punt it away. Dennis Rogan, fair catch at the 15-yard line. Flag down back at the 43-yard line. Well, we got a second. Let's send it to our studios. And Rob, what do you have?
Thanks, Dave. We knew it would be a big afternoon in SEC play, but how about three SEC upsets brewing right now? Coming up at halftime, we'll talk about those. Virginia Tech absolutely steamrolling, number 5 team in the land. And we'll preview Florida, LSU. We'll see you at the break.
What was that? Thank you very much, Rob. Boy, this is a crazy day going on in the SEC. Lane Kiffin and company, by the way, it was a penalty against Tennessee. It'll back him up inside the 10-yard line.
Yeah, this is about the worst field position that they've had all game long. So you see just how hot they are offensively here.
After the holding during that punt return, carry to Montario Hardesty. Tackle made by Geno Atkins, one of those big defensive tackles. Tennessee, actually Georgia, will take a timeout with 1:23, trying to get that football back.
Well, if you're Tennessee and you're in the mind of Lane Kiffin right now, you're trying to run the football, kill some time, and go into halftime. But if you get one to pop for a big play, now you go into that 2-minute mind frame of trying to get some additional points going into halftime.
Time now for a look at our Nissan Heisman history. And, well, when you go to talk about the Bulldogs, you got to go to this man, Herschel Walker, back in 1982, 1,752 yards. But amazingly, he carried it 335 times. And this is where he made a name for himself, in this facility, as he ran over Bill Bates on his way to a touchdown. Of course, Herschel Walker would lead the Dogs to a national championship only 3 years in Athens before he went professional. But you got to love the old tearaway jerseys.
Oh, yeah, loved it. Hey, you know what? Where has it gone? The leap over the goal line. When you give it to a back and a guy gets high and elevates, we don't see that much anymore in college football. Man, we got to bring that back.
You know what,
jump pass came back. We got to bring that back.
The wing T formation is back.
Out of the eye. Honesty. He stopped for a loss of about 4 on the play. Georgia will use another timeout. Justin Houston gets credit for that tackle for loss. That is the last timeout for the Bulldogs and Mark Richt.
with Jonathan Crompton. Let's go back and take a look at that last drive he put together, and he was 4 for 4 on the drive, every one of them play action, holding the linebackers inside, hitting Gerald Jones. You see the play action here, turning his shoulders, nice pass to Denarius Moore, and then he's going to cap it off right here, back of the end zone to Marcellus Teague, the freshman, Jonathan Crompton. 12 of 15, 205 yards, and of those 12 completions, 7 different receivers. That's spreading the wealth, my friend.
Crompton came in averaging 180 yards per game through the air. 9 touchdowns, 8 interceptions. 5 of those touchdowns came in the first game. Look at the total yards. Tennessee has completely doubled up the Bulldogs. They'll hand it off again to Hardesty. Breaks a couple of tackles and finally dragged down by Rennie Curran.
Well, he almost turned the table. That's why the game of football, you know, you refer to it as a chess match, because, you know, you make a move, the opponent makes a move based on down the road. Now Georgia going to spend its final timeout trying to force, I guess, well, we got something going on here. Everybody just kind of lolling around. Actually, they don't. They decide not to stop the clock. But if he breaks that one out and they're able to pick up a first down, now it's time to change it, the mind frame of getting more aggressive to try to go get points. Now you're just in the mindset of, okay, we'll punt and play defense with no time on the clock, or hardly any time.
So Tennessee will have to punt it away with 28 seconds left after the timeout. Georgia's had some success blocking kicks under Mark Richt. Well, let's take a look now at the road to the Dr. Pepper SEC Championship for the Georgia Bulldogs. They've claimed 12 SEC titles, third best in the conference. Alabama leads the way with 21 of those. They've been to the championship game 3 times. They've won a couple of those. And in terms of the 2009 campaign, the Georgia Bulldogs came into this game reeling from a loss last week to LSU, but it didn't deter the fact that Georgia still controlled their own destiny, right, at least to this point. That's how important this game was for Georgia. I mean, it's, you know, I hate to say make or break, Andre, but it's big.
Well, Tennessee trying to pick up their first conference win of the season as well, get themselves to 500 on the year, and we have had one heck of a first half here.
Blocked out of the back of the end zone. Safety for the Bulldogs. Zach Ritter busting through the line, and Georgia picks up the bonus 2 points.
I tell you, you've got it when you're backed up like that. The message to the deep snapper and the punter: get it out of there. Get the snap back to the punter. Catch it. One step it. Get it in the air. Some way, somehow. Morgan Cox, the deep snapper, he does his part, but you take a little bit too long. Chad Cunningham, you'll see it right here. It is coming from right up the middle, right there. Excellent call on the part of the Bulldogs. Going to circle around, actually, the traffic and navigate his way to the punter. And then, there, take it off his foot. He actually does it with one hand.
The Georgia Bulldogs have now blocked 17 punts under Mark Richt. It's the first punt they blocked this year. They blocked a couple of punts last year.
They wanted some points. We just didn't think it would come in the form of a safety.
Boy, special teams big today for the Dogs. The Boykin 100-yard kickoff return. Now the safety, and Georgia will get the football back.
How big were those timeouts? You know, and how big defensively was that stop for Georgia to get it down? And now you set up your punt block team. The play's called, and they execute it to perfection.
Chad Cunningham will punt it away. Boykin stands back at the 25-yard line. The wobbly kick short that will hit. Boykin will pick it up at the 27-yard line. Dancing around and dropped at the 30-yard line.
Let's go back and take a look at that block punt of Chad Cunningham.
You're going to see number 80 lined up here. He's going to come all the way around, navigate his way around the traffic right to the foot of Chad Cunningham. He takes it off just one hand right there. He gets there, but he's only able to get one hand up. Zach Renner, number 80, with the punt block for Georgia.
So 17 seconds to go before halftime. Cox won for his last five here in the opening half. Steps up, fires over the middle, passes caught, A.J. Green. That'll be a first down. Stop the clock with 10 seconds. Inside Tennessee territory at the 47.
And now you can just kind of clock the football, save a little bit of time, get up, snap it, have the quarterback toss it right into the ground.
So you got one more shot to get you in field goal range, perhaps.
Maybe, depending on how fast it's completed and if it's completed for a first down, you might be able to squeeze a second play out of this 8 seconds.
No timeouts for the Dogs. You see Mark Richt's mind just churning.
Boy, he's trying to get an additional three. A 5-point turnaround here before halftime.
Over the middle, Mike Moore to the 34-yard line. That'll stop the clock. 1 second. I don't think they're going to be able to. I don't think it's possible to ground the football without taking a second off the clock. And that's it.
I just couldn't do it. If it's 2 seconds, you got enough time. We'll give them an E for effort, right?
And they got a bonus too. But it was a half dominated by the Tennessee Volunteers. Jonathan Crompton going crazy. 12 out of 15, 205, three touchdowns for the Volunteers. Let's check in with Kara.
Coach, very successful first half for Jonathan Crompton. What went right for him?
Well, he played well. He made really good decisions with the ball, and that's what we need to see. A lot of times he went to a second receiver, made a great play on third down. We got to get our special teams fixed. It's 9-0 in the special teams right now. It should be 21-3.
That's one message at the half. What's the other message?
The other message is to keep playing hard, one snap at a time. We got to get more turnovers, not turnover.
Thanks, Coach. Guys, Coach Kiffin, I knew he was going to point to that special team situation as the big halftime message for the Vols.
Time for us to go to Rob's. Welcome back to our Wrangler SEC Game of the Week from Neyland Stadium, where the Tennessee Volunteers, in front of the home folks, putting on quite a show after 30 minutes of football. Jonathan Crompton and company leading Georgia 21-12. We are moments away from third quarter action. Dave Neal back alongside my partner Andre Ware, won a Heisman 20 years ago.
And 20 years, huh?
Had hard to believe. Well, I'll tell you what, Jonathan Crompton has taken his knocks from the Tennessee faithful over the last year and a half or so. But let me tell you something, he has put all that aside and played exceptional football today.
Well, it's a big game, you know, when you look at the rivalry of Georgia-Tennessee and him really stepping up and playing his part in this football game. He's been unbelievable.
Take a look at our first half highlights brought to you by Nike Pro Combat.
Yeah, he set this one up with a first half touchdown, or first second quarter touchdown to Gerald Jones. They come right back with a kickoff return by Brandon Boykin. He goes the distance, and they knock this baby up, but Crompton, he wasn't finished. He finds Denarius Moore, who finds his way leaping into the end zone, the corner, and then to top things off with a scoring for Tennessee, Marcellus Teague in the back of the end zone. Jonathan Crompton's third first half touchdown pass.
Now, you look at the numbers from Jonathan Crompton, 12 out of 15, Andre, 205, three TDs, perfect half for him. On the flip side, Georgia still can't run the football. They're struggling. They got to get it going. They get the football back first if they can hold on to it. Little pooch kick to kind of control Boykin, who will pick it up at the 20. Sees a little seam out to the 30, and that's where Georgia will set up with their first offensive possession of the second half. Take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Crystal. Nothing like it, and this will show you what kind of offensive output on the ground Georgia had. Just 30 yards on the ground on 9 carries.
Boy, that's tough. And we talked about it at the top. That offensive line has been shuffled around a little bit, but if Georgia's going to go offensively, if they're going to have to do something on the ground, because a lot of their offense built up to play action. You know what? Linebackers don't respect it if you're not running the football.
Monty Kiffin not afraid to blitz today either. We've seen a ton of pressure. Here they come again. Georgia picks it up off the fingertips of the fullback, Sean Chaffis, and let's check in with Kara.
Well, guys, I asked for Coach Rick's points of emphasis at the half. He said for the offense, any score makes it a one-possession game. For the defense, quote, every team in the nation is saying the same thing, stop the bootleg.
And that's pretty much what Lane Kiffin went to. He said, yeah, let's roll them right, roll them left, and Crompton made him pay.
I think that's where he's most comfortable. And Lane Kiffin, sometimes it takes a little while to find out what your quarterback's comfortable doing. I think he's located what Jonathan Crompton likes to do.
Here's Cox. He's not big on running the football, but we'll have Georgia's biggest gain on the ground today. Savion Frazier brings him down, but I don't know if that was a busted play or not, but Georgia can certainly use the 9-yard pickup from their quarterback.
Well, not a bad first half for Joe Cox, 13 of 21. But you see the final stat there, 3 of his last 9. And they were kind of forced into some low passing situation at the end of the first half. Tennessee has been solid defensively.
Washon Ealy, I think his forward progress should get him out over the 41. Dan Williams will get credit for that initial hit. Georgia came in less than 100 yards on the ground.
And it's un-Georgia-like. When you look at 105th in the country, and we're talking to Georgia Bulldogs.
Yeah, it's hard to believe. It's hard to put that number with this team.
No doubt about it. I mean, it's one that you just cannot wrap your fingers around that one and actually believe it. It's almost impossible for Georgia to rush for under 100 yards again.
Georgia's not one of these spread type offenses or a traditional pro style where the running game is such a key element. Here's Ealy. And there's 5 orange jerseys surrounding the football.
And you make a good point, Dave. When you look at Monty Kiffin, we got a chance to talk to him yesterday. A lot of his guys are showing up at the football. They're having fun playing for him. And they gave John Chavis, who is now the defensive coordinator at LSU. You know, we talked to Eric Berry and Rico McCoy. They gave John Chavis a lot of credit about molding their careers in college as well. Kind of happy to play for Monty Kiffin alongside of him.
And the eye formation on second down, pop and snap. Cox will just have to heave it. And it is picked off. It is Dennis Rogan. Cox was just trying to throw it out of bounds, and Rogan snapped it out of midair.
Now he had Ben Martin in his face. And if you're going to throw this one away, you make sure you get it out of bounds and sail it as hard as you can. And Dennis Rogan, that is a gifted interception right into the hands of Dennis Rogan. Right here, you see the missed snap. He's got Ben Martin right in his face. And to add insult to injury, you take a big shot from a guy that big and Ben Martin. But right here, Dennis Rogan, nice job of getting the feet down in bounds.
Swing pass. Zach Rogers, still on his feet. Zach down to the 35-yard line. Rennie Curran brings him down.
And once again, that old thing we talk about, turnover margin. Right there, 115th in the country in turnover margin. And I'm going to tell you right now, that will get you beat most Saturday afternoons.
103,261 in attendance today at Neyland Stadium. And off left side, here's Hardesty to the 30-yard line. Georgia's defense played well in the game last week against LSU. They're going to need to stand tall right now, right here. I think this is a pivotal part of this football game.
You want to talk about tough? Montario Hardesty is tough. He had his knee drained last Monday, still played last week. And you know what? Still averaging and doing a nice job for Tennessee. The average per carry is not there, but he's one of, I think it's one of those games where 2 yards here, 2 yards there, and then a big play. It's coming.
The rollout pass caught by Gerald Jones to the 20, to the 15-yard line. Boy, some misdirection getting Georgia going in every direction. Prince Miller pushes him out of bounds.
You know, all day long they've been able to do this because Georgia, talking about, you see the play action here and the boot from the quarterback. That's the action that's going to hold the linebackers inside. Got to go with the flow. And right there, they're not rushing for a lot of yards, but they're doing just enough to where you have to respect it if you're the Georgia linebackers. It's getting Crompton outside, creating big throwing lanes, and credit him, delivering it on top.
Jones comes in motion. At the handoff to go to Bryce Brown inside the 15, down to the 13-yard line.
With similar styles in Bryce Brown and Montario Hardesty. And a lot of, you know, you look at Bryce Brown, what I like about him is his body lean. A lot of young running backs, they run high. He's bringing the contact. You see the body lean, shoulder pads always over his feet, and they don't lose anything when they bring the true freshman Bryce Brown in and substitute for that young man.
Bryce, the 215-pound true freshman out of Wichita, Kansas, lines up 7 yards deep. Play action to Brown. Compton throws to the end zone. Incomplete. That'll bring up a third down, looking for Gerald Jones in the corner.
You know, it was incomplete, but I liked it because what it tells me is Jonathan Crompton playing with a lot of confidence. That ball was thrown before Gerald Jones came out of his break. Corner of the end zone knew exactly where his receiver was going to end up and tried to put one there where only his receiver's going to catch it. But guess what? We'll come right back on third down.
David Oku checks in, a true freshman running back alongside Crompton.
And you got one-on-one coverage down here at the bottom of the screen.
That's, I think, where Crompton's going. Incomplete. Looking for Denarius Moore. That's exactly what Crompton saw and tried to feed the junior out of Tatum, Texas, working on the coverage.
You see all that congestion inside. It gives you a big throwing lane in which to try to squeeze the football to. Credit Brandon Boykin, because that's a well-thrown football. If he doesn't make that play, it's a completion and might be a first down.
Daniel Lincoln from 30 yards out. Daniel 7 out of 9 in the field goal department this year. Snap is good. The hold is good, and the kick is good. Daniel Lincoln, his first three of the game. Tennessee has now doubled up the dogs. It's 24-12 here in the third quarter. Tennessee leading Georgia 24-12. It's our SEC Network Game of the Week presented by Wrangler. And that scoring drive, 36 yards. Daniel Lincoln with a 30-yard field goal. Crompton just 1 out of 3 on that drive, 14 yards. But it was created by the turnover, and Georgia has struggled, -9. Now make a -11 in the turnover department. Worst in the conference, 115th in the country. And opponents have made Georgia pay along the way in that department as well. They have amounted to 15 turnovers that have resulted in 57 opponent points. Boykin will have to take a knee, and he will bring it up to the 20. Let's go to our studios and check in with Rob again. Rob.
Dave, Georgia at Vanderbilt next weekend. Vandy at Army right now. 10-3 for the Cadets, and give it up for true freshman Warren Norman. The kickoff return goes 76 yards to tie it up at 10s.
Well, Vandy's working their way back in it. 2-3 overall on the season.
From our standpoint, we certainly would like to have Vandy win that game. It'd be a lot easier to go to Nashville next week, wouldn't it? Make our meetings a little bit more comfortable. Out of the I formation, the Dogs trying to get an offensive spark going. They have 9 special teams points and a field goal today. Ealy hit, as soon as he got the football. Savion Frazier makes another tackle. Uga, I think that look on his face says it all.
Yeah, and they got him put up today.
Yeah, let the dogs out.
Let the dogs out.
Come on.
Maybe what's going on. They're not feeling the vibe from Uga.
Play action. Cox has to step up, dumps it off. That pass is going to be incomplete. They will say incomplete, looking for Rashawn Ealy, and he dropped it. That'll bring up a third down and 11 now, and it's hard to win games when you're looking at third down and 7 and more.
Yeah, I thought this was a good call by the officials here. You get the play action and nowhere for Joe Cox to go with the football. Knows where safety valve's located, but you got to make that football move with the ball tucked away in order for that to be ruled a fumble. I think that's a good call by the officials.
Georgia desperately needs a first down. A.J. Green at the top of your screen.
He was busy early, but quiet for a long time, Dave.
Pressure comes. Cox behind his receiver. Incomplete.
Well, you got to credit Monty Kiffin for this defensive game plan that he has drawn up. And, you know, we talked to Mark Richt earlier in the week, and he talked about running the football. And I think you get carried away with, we've got to run the football. And you just kind of start beating your head against, well, if the pass is working, that's a way to allow you to run the football. Throw some passes to soften the defense up a little bit. Now, Cox, 3 of his last 12. And 1 interception to go along with it, but you can settle him down. Running the football, Tennessee is on top of that.
Nice tight spiral, booming kick by Butler, touched by Rogan. It's a loose football. Who's got it? I think Rogan came up with it, but another booming punt by Drew Butler. There's a mad scramble. Darryl Gamble comes out of there with a helmet, Tennessee helmet in his hand. A 57-yard kick by Drew Butler. Leads the country with a 49.8 average.
Let's take a look at this. And, you know, Dennis Rogan's usually a sure-handed return man. This one kind of gets over his shoulder, and he misjudges it. But guess what? Now you got to locate the football. And I thought he did a nice job of kind of redirecting himself to the football. And
didn't
covering
panic.
That baby up. No, didn't panic.
Well, here comes Tennessee on first down and 10. Honesty. Maybe a yard. Well, the best in women's basketball are set to hit the stage at the ESPNU Road to the Championship held in San Antonio on November 17th. Watch the Lady Vols take on Texas Tech. And the national champion UConn Huskies battle Texas. For tickets, call 1-800-745-3000 or visit ESPNUroadtothechampionship.com for more information. Bryce Brown in at tailback. He will set up to the left of Jonathan Crompton. Crompton 13 out of 18, 219, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Through the hands and picked off. Bakari Rambo to the end zone. Touchdown Bulldogs.
And this is what played Tennessee last week against Auburn. Drop passes, passes hitting receivers and laying it on the ground. This one pops into the air. And right there, Bakari Rambo, a redshirt freshman, takes it in for Georgia. Guy, you get your hands on the football, Dave, quarterback hits you like that, you gotta catch the football.
Going after is up and good for Blair Walsh. His streak is now at 66 point afters in a row. Boy, Georgia needed some sort of spark, and they may have gotten it from the Rambo interception. He takes it back 28 yards. It's 24-19 Tennessee. Welcome back to the Wrangler SEC Game of the Week. It is a doozy here in Knoxville, 24-19. It has been kind of a weird, strange game how we've gotten these points on the board, but it's just a five-point contest with 8:21 to go in the third quarter. There's the man of the moment, the redshirt freshman, Bakari Rambo out of Donaldsonville, Georgia. Just struck with an interception return for a touchdown. And Georgia finally gets a turnover. Off the fingertips of that man moments ago, Zach Rogers. Here's Walsh with the kick. It's a deep kick, sends Richardson all the way back to the end of the end zone, and Tennessee will bring it out to the 20. Let's go back to that interception, Andre.
Well, it's a simple slant route by Zach Rogers, the inside slot receiver. You're going to get just a nice little slant right here, and there's a big window to throw into. If you're Jonathan Crompton, just put it in front of him. You'll say it hits the receiver in the hands, but it's a tough catch when you're all your momentum right here. You're gonna get the nice push and a nice slant route inside right there. Now just throw it in front of him, throw him a nice catchable ball. You got a big play from your freshman receiver. You throw it behind him, it's a tough adjustment. Gets tipped into the air and Rambo to the end zone. Now you put Georgia right back in the football game.
Off left side. Here's Hardesty. He'll get five on the carry. But this is, I told you, it's been a strange game how we've scored some of these points.
Yeah.
And you look at how Georgia's done it today. 3 on offense, 9 on special teams with a 100-yard kickoff return by Boykin, and then a blocked punt through the end zone for a safety, and now the interception by Rambo.
Well, Joe Cox and the offense, they need to go thank the special teams as well as the defense for keeping them in this one. And now, with a lot of time left in the football game, maybe they can get something going on the offensive side of the ball.
Crompton throws. It's the fullback, Kevin Cooper, and he is swallowed up by the man of the moment, Bakari Rambo, with a good open field tackle. That'll bring up third down. You know, the other thing that interception did, it really sucked the life out of this crowd. They were rocking and rolling.
This stadium was going crazy. We'll take a look at the interception again. The slant route, watch it, thrown behind Zach Rogers. And this is where Jonathan Crompton had problems last week against Auburn. Watching film on him, he just kept throwing the football behind receivers, and it was tough catches for him.
That'll be a first down. Luke Stocker with a big grab. Let's go to our studios, Rob.
Dave, number 17 Auburn trying to stage a late game rally in Fayetteville. Ben Tate, his second touchdown in the span of 1 minute 22 seconds. This one goes for 60 yards. He's over 160 yards for the day, 34-16 now.
Well, the Tigers trying to do something. You knew that. I mean, they are such a high-powered offense, Andre, among the elite in the country. It was only a matter of moments.
Well, Gus Malzahn, excellent offensive coordinator.
Here's Crompton on first down. All day to throw over the middle. Pass caught at the 47-yard line to Narius Moore, who has stepped up big today.
Boy, and this is where Jonathan Crompton has been effective. Play-action pass where he's moving a little bit. Even though it's straight back in the pocket, you see Denarius Moore push off, square the route off, and nice and flat where the safety can't make a play over the top. If you round that off, you round it right into Rashad Jones, and it allows him to make a play. But bootleg passes, play-action passes, Jonathan Crompton's been on the money. It's when you drop him straight back
or
out of the shotgun where he's not moving. That's where he tends to struggle a little bit.
That's just weird. I mean, I'd like to get your thought on why that is after this play. Handoff right side, Bryce Brown with a couple of yards. But why do you think that is? It seems like it would be easier not to be moving around.
My friend, I think it takes a doctor and a sofa to figure that one out. I'd make a lot of money if I knew the answer to that, baby. No, quarterbacks are just different. Some are comfortable doing certain things, and I think it's up to a coaching staff and coach to figure that out. It's okay, if we're going to move him around, maybe it's a short roll and allow him to throw it instead of a straight back and a straight drop back, because that's where he struggles, is when crossing routes or slant routes, he tends to throw behind it.
Out of the eye, it's the up back, the fullback, Austin Johnson. Get a couple. It helps, I guess, Lane Kiffin play quarterback himself at Fresno State, so maybe he has a little bit of a better feel in that regard.
And as well, you know, June Jones told me a long time ago that you have to figure out a quarterback certain balls tail a certain way. Like a receiver coming from your right to left, you throw the football, it might tail a yard to the right. So you can lead that receiver. If you're coming, the route's coming from your left to right, you throw it out in front or right on the receiver, and it actually ends up just in front of him. Everybody and every quarterback's just a little bit different.
Third and six for the Vols. Quick drop, quick hit. Pass caught, first down Tennessee. Inside the Georgia 40, down to the 38-yard line. That's Newkeese Richardson with his fifth catch of the season, the true freshman out of Pahokee, Florida.
Boy, the fans love this kid, and he is electric right here. Sit it down in zone coverage between two defenders. Find that nice little soft spot and set your number for the quarterback.
How about this, Andre? That is the eighth different receiver today to catch a ball for Tennessee.
He's getting people involved today and spreading the football around. You know what it's doing? It's driving Willie Martinez, the defensive coordinator for Georgia, driving him crazy.
Hardesty cuts it back. Hardesty to the 20, to the 10. Touchdown, Tennessee. 39 yards.
About it, Dave. Peck, 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 and then the big one. And there it is. Montario Hardesty didn't have a high yard per carry average and came in at 5.5 yards a carry, but it just kept, you know, you stay the course. Take what's there, take what the defense is giving you, and then all of a sudden that opportunity to hit the home run, it's going to present itself.
One after is up and good by Daniel Lincoln. Montario Hardesty, the leading rusher in the Southeastern Conference, takes it 39 yards.
That video resume.
Getting better and better, isn't it? 31-19, Vols out in front. Georgia, Tennessee on the banks of the Tennessee River, where the Vols lead the Bulldogs 31-19, 4:06 to go in the third quarter. Montario Hardesty has put on a show all season. He has been their bell cow offensively. And this time today, kind of the passing game set him up. Usually it's Hardesty setting up the passing game, but Montario, 39 yards on that touchdown run, giving the Vols a 31-19 lead. Langham to kick it off. It's a line drive. Boykin with a 100-yard touchdown return already this afternoon. He's out over the 30 to the 33-yard line. Let's go back to that run by Montario Hardesty.
Boy, let's take a look at it. A zone play where you're going to get blocks, just everybody pushing. It's going to create a nice big lane for Montario Hardesty right here coming backside. But you watch the block of number 40. Freeze it right there. Right there. Watch that block by number 40, Austin Johnson. Just enough of the defender, Darius Dewberry, to create a nice running lane for the big guy. 16 carries, 46 yards before that one. Now for the day, 17 for 85.
With a throw back, Tennessee read it well, looking for Green, but he breaks a tackle. That should have been about an 8-yard loss. Green comes up, gets popped. I believe that was Art Evans, possibly, that hit A.J. Green.
Yeah, Art Evans, solid corner. Great instincts.
Let's take a look at our game summary brought to you by Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. There's the storyline. Jonathan Crompton with a great afternoon.
Yeah, total yards, you see it. They're dominated by Tennessee. 369 yards of total offense.
Rashawn Ely out of the game. Carlton Thomas in a tailback. But it's a Logan Gray, the backup quarterback in Georgia, trying to get a little spark, running a little wildcat. But let's go to Rob.
Dave, Auburn and Arkansas have combined for 777 total offensive yards. A lot of sevens, that scares me. 60-yard reverse by Terrell Zachary would lead to an Ontario McCaleb touchdown. 20 unanswered Tiger points, 34-23, end of the third.
Oh, the Razorbacks think it was over? They put it on shutdown a little bit early.
Here's Moore. On third down and 11, incomplete. Eric Berry on the coverage for the Vols, and the Dogs will have to punt.
They are doing everything they can to try to create some type of running game. Logan Gray coming in the Wildcat formation, trying to carry the football, and then they're going to go back to Joe Cox, unable to connect with Michael Moore, and Tennessee riding a wave of momentum, about 100,000. That momentum is about at 100,000 right now. I don't think anybody in the stadium sitting down.
Drew Butler to punt. His last one went 57 yards. Nearly created a turnover. Dennis Rogan back at his 25. Line drive kick that will hit at the 29. And will be touched by the Dogs back at the 32-yard line.
So that's fun like your sandwich.
I wish. Well, time for us to recognize Andrew Jensen from Georgia and Cody Solins from Tennessee as our SEC Network Scholar Athletes of the Game. ESPN Regional Television will contribute $1,000 to Georgia and Tennessee's general scholarship funds on their behalf. Congratulations to those guys on getting it done in the classroom.
No doubt, that's what it's all about.
Boy, you've seen Tennessee hopping around today like they haven't hopped around in a few years around here. They just got this. What a swagger to him today.
You know, Monty Kiffin, he told us yesterday this was one he was looking forward to. A little more of a conventional offense.
He's tired of seeing these spreads and varieties of the spread offense. Here's Brown off the right side to the 30. Give him a couple on the play. But that's a good point that, you spend a lot of time preparing. And this week it's almost old school type football. It's what they practice against.
You see Wildcat stuff. You see, spread offenses, all different types of things for the last 5 weeks, something different. Now all of a sudden, here come the Georgia Bulldogs. It's like looking in the mirror. Things you've worked on in spring practice, in two-a-day camp. It's a little bit easier to defend, and I think you're seeing it for Tennessee today.
Second down, the handoff. Hardesty. Look at the young man. Just carry people for a first down. Well, he's carrying 600, 700 pounds on his back for a first down.
This is just about the same as the touchdown run. Play here coming right out the front side. He didn't cut this one back. It's just to the left side of the formation as opposed to the right. He stays front side with it. And now credit the big guys, both the Sullins brothers up front, Jack McClendon, Aaron Douglas, and Chris Scott, that big offensive line. Unbelievable. Last year against Georgia, you see the rushing yard, 1 yard rushing.
Good play action, Vice Crockett, all days going up top, wide open. That will be a touchdown for Tennessee, Gerald Jones. 52 yards. Listen to this place go crazy. Tennessee fans have been waiting for a day like this in the SEC for a long, long time.
Boy, what a well-designed football play. All day long, Denarius Moore has been coming down in play action and going outside. Watch the move that he throws on the corner at the top. Right here, I'm going to sit on the comeback. I'm fooling you, I'm going to the house. And a well-thrown football from Jonathan Crawford. Excuse me, Gerald Jones. How about this? They're feeling it a little bit. Feeling it a little bit.
Jonathan Crompton is putting on a show.
Clinic. And keep in mind, it was play action with a little bit of a roll. Set your feet and go up top. When you keep him in the pocket, for some reason it just kind of floats behind receivers a little bit. But look at the numbers today. 18 of 24, 301. That number I like right there. Four touchdown passes.
Yeah, I think you'd like that quarterback. Down to the 5-yard line. Here's Boykin. Boykin. And a flag comes in back at the 20-yard line.
This young talent for Tennessee, Dave, starting to rise to the top.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 45 on the receiving team. A penalty half an inch to the goal.
Boy, let's take a look at that touchdown pass. And Gerald Jones, he sets this up all day long. A little comeback on the outside, comeback on the outside. And now I'm just going to take it, give me the comeback move, and I'm going to the post right there. It's excellent. Freezes the corner. Jonathan Crompton right on time. That's a big-time throw and catch.
A.J. Green, nothing happening. Couldn't shake three orange jerseys.
We'll check out the pass right here. Hits his man right in stride. Just a little pull away from Prince Miller, who bit on the little out move, and there's a reaction. No, hey, I just threw my fourth one of the day against a rival football team, the Georgia Bulldogs. Senior quarterback feeling pretty good right now, Dave.
That man's not feeling very good, Mark Ricks. Second down and 10. Cox going up top. Nearly picked off by Art Evans. Looking for Michael Moore. It'll be third down and 10.
Yeah, Joe Cox, sometimes you get a little bit desperate when you get frustrated, want to hit a big one. And pump fakes and trying to go over the top. And Art Evans, I don't know if there's been better coverage on any receiver today. Excellent coverage by Art Evans. He ain't going to get behind him. He was a 10, 300-meter guy out of high school.
Sean Chappis. And here comes the punt team, and the crowd is rocking Neyland Stadium.
You know, we were talking with defensive coordinator Monty Kiffin. He's talking about the first four games. He said, you know what? They ought to have preseason in college. He was joking with us. Yeah, now it's time to start over.
We just now figured this out.
They might have started over right now today. This may be the start over point for Tennessee. That man has called one heck of a football game defensively.
Butler stands in the checkerboard end zone. Newkeese Richardson at midfield. Another good kick. Bounces at the 37-yard line. It'll be down at the 38, and that will wrap up the first or the third quarter, which belonged to Tennessee. Jonathan Crompton. We'll be back with the fourth quarter in a moment. Volunteers looking impressive, Andre. 38 to 19.
offense and defense. One little special teams hiccup.
Lane Kiffin has talked about, you know, trying to don't look at the scoreboard. Let's be as good as we can be on this play. And at the end of the day, we will look at the scoreboard. And he's looking for that first SEC win. And against a rival like Georgia, it's got to feel pretty good. Now, we still have 15 minutes to go.
Looking pretty good, but let's finish the deal is what you're thinking right now. And that should be
his message to his
football team.
It's like 15 minutes, or it could be, it feels like 15 days to him probably. First down and 10, Tennessee from the 38-yard line. Hardesty bounces forward for about four. Time to send it back to Rob with an update.
Guys, Auburn had reeled off 20 unanswered points to pull within 11, but Broderick Green with a 3-yard run stops the bleeding. These two teams have combined for 822 total yards. Let me tell you, 1,000 is not out of the question.
Oh my goodness, are they playing some football on the offensive side of the ball in Fayetteville? Back to the line of scrimmage. Not much happening there, but a lot going on in the league right now. And when you look at the AP poll in terms of teams ranked in the top 25 among BCS conference, Big 12 and SEC up there, SEC with three teams obviously in the upper echelon, the elite status. You know, but I think there's still so much football left to play. Of course, LSU and Florida going at it. Somebody's going to be bumped down out of that matchup.
That's a heavy debate of conferences and which, you know, which conference is the best. SEC and Big 12, those are the first two. And then I think you can just kind of, everybody else falls into place.
Here's Richardson to midfield. That'll be a first down for Tennessee. Rennie Curran tracks him down. That is seven tackles for Rennie Curran, but you hear the new for New Keese.
This crowd really wants to get behind New Keese Richardson, and they'll figure out a way to get him more touches as Tennessee goes forward, because he is one heck of a weapon for Lane Kiffin in this Tennessee offense.
Pretty productive afternoon for New Keese, 71 yards on those four carries.
Yeah, they've got a little package where they want to get him the football, get him a little work at quarterback, and their wildcat look, two or three plays a game, and they'll line him up and direct snap it to him.
Like a little movement against Tennessee.
False start, number 66 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
On an overcast afternoon in Knoxville, Tennessee. Georgia and Tennessee squaring off in a long-standing rivalry that dates back to 1899. Dave Neal, Andre Ware, Kara Capuano. It's our SEC Network Game of the Week presented by Wrangler. Georgia's one of their few sparks has been the Boykin 100-yard kickoff return. But the story today is really a combination of Jonathan Crompton and Montario Hardesty. Bryce Brown with that carry. He gets nothing. Jeff Owens will get credit for the first man on the spot for a tackle. Take a look at our Liberty Mutual play of the game.
Yeah, it's that rollout and the first touchdown pass to Gerald Jones, and that really kind of set the tone for Jonathan Crompton and this Tennessee offense. Got him going, Dave.
It did. It was, you know, we talked about the confidence of Crompton, and Lane Kiffin has spoken too. It's kind of a roller coaster with him in terms of ups and downs, and I think that touchdown, Andre, set him on the right course today.
Happened early enough and really got his feet under him. He's played a heck of a ball game.
Second down and long. Crompton throws. Running left, throwing right. Pass caught by Denarius Moore. That'll pick up about seven.
Let me tell you, that's a tough throw. You're rolling left and you're throwing from one hash mark to the other, and it's on a rope. And able to get there. That takes a little bit of athletic ability right there.
You know, once again, I think it bears repeating in that there have been struggles. I mean, I think a lot of people have wanted a change of quarterback. Lane Kiffin tells us yesterday, I flat out asked him about how long is the leash with Crompton, and he says he's our guy. He gives us our best chance to win, and that's the end of the story.
He understands the system, knows what checks to get him in and out of. That goes a long way in the ball game.
Gerald Jones. That'll be incomplete. And fourth down coming up. Boykin a little bit slow to get off the corner. Look, he might have a little bit of a hamstring issue the way he was grabbing that right hamstring. There's David Reeves to the right of Jonathan Crompton, quarterback coach.
You see it right here playing press coverage, and they're trying to throw a little quick screen out to Gerald Jones. Pulling hard to see out the kick out on the corner. And Boykin, who had that big-time kick return for a touchdown, a little slow to get up.
Ron Corson, the head athletic trainer for the Georgia Bulldogs, been there a long time. On the left of your screen, helping Boykin pop up. He is one of the best in the business. Those two. You know, we both talked about it, and Lane Kiffin mentioned it to us. That, you know, somebody in this receiving corps is going to have to really step up and kind of be the leader of that group. Gerald Jones, slow out of the gates due to some injuries.
Well, they were going back and forth, changing in and out receivers, you know, here and there. Gerald Jones didn't even start the season. He was out with a leg injury, a high ankle sprain, and just really getting his feet under him. And all of a sudden, you get Quentin Hancock coming around. Everybody all of a sudden is finding their way to the same page, and they're benefiting offensively.
Cunningham's punt. That will hit into the end zone. That will be a touchback. Georgia will have it at the 20 when we come back. But it has been all Tennessee to this point in the second half. They lead the Dogs 38-19. 38-19, Tennessee out in front. Fourth quarter football, 11:04 to go in the contest. I'll tell you what, this has been a complete performance. Other than a few special team lapses by Tennessee, they have played good football on both sides of the ball today. Georgia needs something. I think if nothing else, just to gain a little bit of confidence. They need some success here. A couple of first downs. That handoff goes to Carlton Thomas, and he'll pick up the first down at the 33-yard line. Joe Cox in the third quarter. Andre.
Tough. You see there, 2 of 9, the interception with just -2 yards passing in the third quarter. That is a tough way to make a living on a Saturday afternoon.
Here goes Thomas again. He'll take it to the 37-yard line, brought down by Rico McCoy, who has 6 tackles today. He's coming off a 16-tackle performance last week. Rico McCoy, not the biggest linebacker, 6'1", 220, out of Washington, D.C. Great talking with him yesterday. What a personality.
Oh, my goodness. It was a lot of fun visiting with that young man.
Carlton Thomas. He's out to the 44-yard line. That'll be a first down for Georgia.
Yeah, we came in thinking offensively that A.J. Green had to be a factor. He's having a fantastic year for Georgia on the offensive side of the football. Attempted 8 passes to him. He's caught 7 for 55. I think you start thinking about going back there.
There you go, right on cue. Complete near midfield. He had 5 receptions in the first half for 57 yards.
Yeah, a little speed out right here. Get the cornerback in a back pedal and break it off. Nice route, good hands. But that's a guy. If they're going to get back in this ball game, number 8's got to put his hands on the football.
And Andre, I mean, he just needs some help. I mean, they need somebody else to make some plays on offense.
Yeah, Monty Kiffin has done an excellent job. You know, you'll give him 7, 8 receptions, but making it tough for Georgia offensively. And they've gotten nice pressure on Joe Cox as well.
4-man rush. Dump it off to the tailback, Carlton Thomas, and he will be about 1.5 yards shy of the first down marker. Rico McCoy hanging on for another tackle.
Got something going here. All day long, the Bulldogs have lived in third down and long. You see the master of defense direct in traffic, Monty Kiffin.
Cox, pressure comes, throws it out of bounds on third down and short. Georgia at a point now where they're just going to have to go for it.
Well, you made a good point early. Eric Berry playing in that box. And a guy that can really do a lot of things for you defensively. They decide to blitz him right there. And he doesn't get there, but he just creates enough havoc for Joe Cox where he's got to get rid of the football. And he throws the errant pass.
Georgia's struggling on the ground continues.
Well, they're meandering around. Looks like they're coming again.
Good strong throw. Ball bound in the air. Taken away by Eric Berry. Still on his feet. Berry to the 20. Down to the 15-yard line.
To get his helmet right on the football, and then Eric Berry. Johnny on the spot comes up with it, and he's excellent at returning and picking these off in the air. You see his teammates, they want to throw nice blocks out in front and free him up. Excellent job defensively by Tennessee.
I know a lot of Tennessee fans were wondering if that was an interception. They're going to rule it a catch and a fumble.
Yeah, and I think that's the right call.
Crompton to the air in the corner of the end zone, and feet get tangled up, and there will be a flag.
Yeah, that one's going to be on Prince Miller, the cornerback, working against Gerald Jones. They get tangled, and this is going to be a first, I think, goal-to-goal situation, about half the distance to the goal here for Tennessee.
We'll go back to that. The reason it's important in terms of statistical perspective for Eric Berry is he was only 15 yards shy. Shy of an NCAA career record for return yards off interceptions. And right now sitting at second behind Terrell Buckley of Florida State. But it was not an interception. It was a fumble return.
Boy, I tell you what, they use him in a lot of different ways defensively, but he is an excellent football player for Tennessee.
Quick snap, Crompton rolling, firing, pass. Big hit right at the 1 yard line by Prince Miller. Gerald Jones just couldn't sneak it in the end zone. Crompton looking for his fifth touchdown pass of the game.
Well, coaches think Gerald Jones is going to be a superstar in this offense. 6 foot, 199 pounds. And let's go back and take a look at this play. You look at it. Michael Moore catches it, turns, and then Art Evans puts his helmet right on the football. But that is definitely a catch and a fumble.
Crompton play fake over the middle. Incomplete. Flag comes in. From 30 yards away. Well, I just looked down at the Georgia sideline. Willie Martinez, the defensive coordinator, just picked up his play sheet. He just threw it in the air.
Pass interference, number two on the defense. That penalty will be half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
Well, a little quarterback sneak now, Dave. That's the medicine to get Tennessee well in this situation. Get down this close. They played so well inside. Both Sullins brothers, the center and the left guard, Chris Scott, Jack McClendon, and Aaron Douglas, the offensive line for Tennessee. Got to give them credit. They have played an excellent football game up front.
Cross ball, touchdown, Tennessee.
Check it out. Talking about the offensive line. Big Chris Scott just caving everything down inside. And Bryce Brown's able to walk into the end zone.
Link Falcons point after is up and good. Everybody getting in on the action today. 45 points today, most against Georgia since the 51-point output in 2006. How did that touchdown get started? How about number 14, your All-American, Eric Berry, out of Fairburn, Georgia, set it all up with the fumble return. Your eyes are not deceiving you, folks. 45-19 in the fourth quarter. Celebrating its fifth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point. Today, Allstate has contributed more than $1.8 million in scholarship monies. Eric Berry with a fumble return. 35 yards on that pickup. And the student section.
He's going to be a little disappointed when he finds out.
We're talking about that.
That one was ruled a fumble instead of an interception.
Yeah, they announced it on the big board here that he set a new record. Brandon Smith tripped up at the 25. Time for another update. Let's go to our studios, Rob. Quarterback is Logan Gray. He will hand it off to Richard Samuel. He gets hit at the 43-yard line, but Georgia's best run of the afternoon. Frazier will get credit for that stop, but a big hit on Samuel.
He started the game, hadn't really carried it a whole lot. They have had problems today running the football, the Georgia Bulldogs. Credit that Tennessee front seven. Playing without Nick Revez in the middle. Savion Frazier moves inside, and well, he's played big.
Gray step back, fires. That pass is caught to Marlon, complete to Marlon Brown. Logan Gray getting some action today. The sophomore out of Columbia, Missouri, also works with special teams. A couple of really talented true freshman quarterbacks that I think Mark Richt really wants to keep that, keep them off the field and take a redshirt year.
Yeah.
Logan Gray, one of the best athletes, if not the best athlete on this team. Good step up in the pocket. He'll run a little bit. Logan popped at the 45. Twisted around by Rico McCoy and company.
Well, Logan's going to learn to get down. You know, at 6'2", 192 pounds, you're running into 6'1", 220. That doesn't equate very well in his favor, but you got to get down. Athletic quarterback like that, that's what he brings to the position for Georgia. A guy that can make some plays with his legs. And oh boy, start sliding.
Not a real good day for Joe Cox. 147 yards, couple of touchdowns, but he didn't get a whole lot of help from anybody. Richard Samuel dropped behind the line by Savion Frazier. That is 8 tackles for Savion. Remember, he's a young man that's having to play, as Andre said, for Nick Revaez, who got hurt.
Yeah, he was outside linebacker, and moved inside. And I'll tell you what, they've added a little bit more speed on the field with that move, putting him in the middle.
Made his first career start last week against Auburn, had 11 stops in that game. Here goes Samuel running hard to the 40-yard line. Jansen Jackson, the freshman out of Lake Charles, Louisiana, from a safety spot, comes up.
There's Nick Revaez with a knee injury.
The junior out of Farragut, Tennessee, just down the road, of course. Continuing the family tradition, father a kicker here. He's having to watch, and that young man was an inspiration to a lot of people on this defense. Third down, batted down.
Guess who?
That would be 43 in orange, would it?
No, number 14.
Oh.
1-4, always around the football. Boy, is he a good football player. Watch him. Watch him up top right there. Number 14. Elevating, getting both hands on the football. Now that would have been a nice one. Pick that one off, come at full speed. Nobody between 14 and the goal line.
Fourth down. 5:15 to play. Gray, good strong throw, but behind his receiver, the tight end Aaron White, and it'll be Tennessee football.
And Chris Walker's right in the lap of Logan Gray, which caused that errant throw.
Monty Kiffin's defense came to play today. Back in a moment. Jonathan Crompton will watch the rest of this one with 5:09 to play in the fourth quarter. His club up 45-19. Nick Stevens comes in, his backup. He's completed all four of his passes he has attempted this year. The junior out of Flower Mound, Texas.
And he can throw it. He can throw it around. Watched him in practice the opening week of the season. And I'll tell you what, very impressed with Nick Stevens.
Oku with the carry.
Let's take a look at Jonathan Crompton's day. 20 of 27, four touchdown passes and the interception. But he got it started to Gerald Jones, little play action. That got the scoring started for Tennessee. And then Denarius Moore breaking tackles, elevating into the end zone. Finds Marcellus Teague in the back of the end zone. Three touchdown passes in the first half. And the beauty, over the top play action. Little give and go. And Gerald Jones catching the fourth touchdown pass of Jonathan Crompton.
Handoff off the left side to Bryce Brown. Let's take a look now at our Wrangler five-star player of the game, and I'll give you a guess who it is.
Gotta be that man. 20 of 27, 310 yards, the four touchdown passes. The interception, that one was tipped in the air. Just about a perfect day for Jonathan Crompton.
And he got help in the receiving department with Gerald Jones, five catches, 105 yards. You've got Moore with four catches, 73 yards. Stocker, four catches, 68 yards.
Yeah, eight different receivers. That's spreading the ball around. And I think this type of game came for Jonathan Crompton at just the right time.
Third down, handoff to Oku, met at the line of scrimmage. By the way, total offense today, 455 for Tennessee, 239 for Georgia. The Vols are averaging 7.6 yards per play to Georgia's 4.1.
Well, it's been tough, tough going for Georgia offensively. Lane Kiffin has called an excellent game on one side of the football, and Dad's called an excellent game on the other side. Monty Kiffin has been brilliant.
Yes.
Defensively for Tennessee.
What a game plan he put together. I think it was a great coaching job by Tennessee today.
No doubt about it.
Cunningham to punt it away. Prince Miller will field it back at the six. His knee hit the ground. They'll say no, but he takes it out to the 14-yard line. 50-yard punt, 4-yard return. Lane Kiffin seeking his first Southeastern Conference victory. 2:57 to play.
With under a minute left in regulation, Vanderbilt banged in the field goal off the goalpost to force OT. In OT, Alex Carlton for Army hits it off the same upright for the win. The Cadets take it by three.
Ouch.
Ouch. Oh, boy. That's a tough one. We'll see Vandy next week.
Yeah, meeting should be a lot of fun. I'll let you ask the first question. Here's Rashawn Ealy. I think Mark Rick just content to run this one out. 45 points, most allowed by Georgia this year. This club has given up 37 points three times this season in three out of six games. It's a back of the drawing board right now for Mark Richt and company. And I gotta say this, you know, we've harped on the running game, but you're five games now, six games into the season.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to change. I mean, if you can't run the ball by now, I don't know, you know, you might get a little bit better, but I mean, you kind of know who you are at this point.
You know who you are. And the strength of the football team, especially offensively. Boy, that was close to an interception. But the strength of Georgia's football team on the offensive side are the receivers. And you might be in a situation where you have to throw your way into running the football. But today they had issues running the football, protecting Joe Cox. A lot of circumstances surrounding their lack of productivity on the offensive side of the ball today.
Third down coming up. Logan Gray still in at quarterback. Here's Ely with a handoff. He gets met and drops right back to the line of scrimmage. Looks like Chris Walker among those in on the play along with Gerald Williams. That'll bring up fourth down. Here's what I'm going to take away from this game.
Yeah.
That Tennessee is getting better each week. And I think that the confidence kind of came out. Even though they lost last week, I think the fourth quarter did a lot to set this team up for today.
Well, keep in mind, it's a young football team. Take away Montario Hardesty, and you've got a lot of young talent for Tennessee on both sides of the football. That talent, Dave, after 5 weeks of football, starting to grow up a little bit, and maybe you're not quite as in awe of the Southeast Conference as you once were to start the season. Those guys now, it's just football to them. They're a little bit older, a little bit more experienced, and they're cutting loose a little bit more. And I think that's what you take away from this Tennessee bunch, is that you're right, they're getting better and better each and every week.
Drew Butler will stand in his end zone to punt it away. We've said that quite a few times today. Wobbly kick. Lukeys Richardson will let it hit at midfield. And he will get away. The ball will drop down at the 41-yard line. Let's take a look at the upcoming schedule for Tennessee, brought to you by Toyota. Moving forward, an off week next week, and then usually the third Saturday, but it's the fourth Saturday this month. They go to Alabama, who you and I believe they'll be kicking it off here in about 5 minutes.
Might be the best team in the country.
Right.
In my opinion, I mean, two teams, one will get knocked off tonight, it's either Florida or LSU, but Alabama is playing as well as anybody in the country.
So that's what Tennessee will have 2 weeks to get ready for, and they'll probably need it. As the top rows of Neyland Stadium are emptying out. Not much red and black left in this building. Torian Poole gets a carry to the 46 and stays in bounds, and the clock will continue to run. For Georgia, where do you go from here, Andre?
Well, I think you have to evaluate yourself and not really try. That run in the football is what you're used to doing. Maybe this is a different bunch for Georgia this season, and it's going to take spreading people out a little bit more to kind of create the running lanes and the blocking angles in order to run the football. I think they've got quality backs. They'll get Caleb King back next week. But they've got a weapon on the outside, A.J. Green. And I think maybe you ride the receivers a little while in order to soften people up, and that will allow you to run the football.
Oku with the carry with the first down, and that will do it for this one. Mark Richt, this will sting. This will absolutely sting. I asked him about the importance of this game in our meetings, and he said it's very important. It's a critical ball game for a lot of reasons.
Yeah, one that they're trying to stay in the thick of things in the conference and in the eastern part of the SEC, and this one gonna put them behind the eight ball a little bit.
There's a look at the story. Georgia goes to 2-2 in league play. Tennessee picking up their first conference win. They go to 3-3 overall as well. So Lane Kiffin picking up his first Southeastern Conference win, and there it is. The shout. Come on, Lane, you can smile.
He's thinking about right now?
Alabama?
No, he's thinking about special teams giving up 9 points. Even though they hung 45 on Georgia, coaches always think about what we could have done better. It's like the never-ending search for that perfect round of golf. No matter how good you play, you look at it at the end of the day, you could have played better.
All right. We will step aside, put a wrap on things. Win and return. Tennessee wins it 45-19. Today's SEC Network game has been brought to you by Champion. It's how you play.